Zabby's mentor is Glendora, a similarly single monikered producer from Westchester, who has sued Cablevision and other corporations in federal courts across the country, and is also a plaintiff in the suit in Missouri, where Cablevision has not operated since 1997. That's the purpose, to get them out of Cablevision land, to get a court where we can get a fair forum where they don't know who Cablevision is. But Glendora is now the subject of a rare Martin Trigona sanction named for a disbarred lawyer who filed hundreds of vexatious pro se suits and was eventually prohibited by the Second Circuit from filing any more without a judge's prior approval. Okay, I'm going to correct all of the misinformation in that paragraph. Here we go. 52 proved that Glendora is her mentor, that Glendora is the mentor of Zabby. This is a lie, and defendants are sued for this lie. Read Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 6. Your paragraph is too long, your sentence lies, has too many independent clauses. Your English construction is as abysmal as your legal construction. If you knew how to be reporters, editors, and publishers, you would check the Second Circuit, and you would find that this phony sanction has been lifted. You would know that Glendora has an oral argument before the triumvirate on September 7, 2000, Anno Domini. And let me write a post-it on that to put up a graphic about that oral argument, September 7th, come. If you knew, you would also know that the phony sanction was manufactured on a lie and a hoax by Ralph K. Winter, the former chief judge of the Second Circuit, and that it left when Winter left. You would also know that Glendora has sued Winter multitudinous times for his traitorship to the USA, to you, the public. You would also know that U.S. Supreme Court justice stood up for Glendora and opposes this anti-Americanism by people like Winter. His name is Stevens. Glendora got a dissent from the United States Supreme Court. Glendora was winterized because she caught Winter cheating. She exposed him in her court papers, and she exposed him to you on TV. And she sued him. Now, this is all great news defendants miss because of myopia, and because of cowardice, and because of failure to fight for the red, white, and blue. When are you going to tell the public what is really going on in their courts? These courts belong to you. When is New York Law Journal going to tell you what is going on in your courts? The cheating, the lying, the stealing, the traitorship to the United States of America and everything it stands for. You misrepresent that Glendora ever filed a vexatious lawsuit, and you are sued for the same. What was vexatious was the cheating of dirty lawyers and dirty judges. You cover up the same because they feed your greed. You cover up the same New York Law Journal because lawyers and judges, dirty as they are, feed your greed. It's the lawyers and the judges who subscribe to the New York Law Journal. The New York Law Journal, paragraph 17. An outside lawyer for Cablevision has filed a short letter with such court pointing out the lack of jurisdiction in Philadelphia, Detroit, Los Angeles, and elsewhere, and outlining Glendora's litigious history. Cablevision has sold off most of its holdings outside the tri-state area. In each case, the complaints were thrown out as a result. This is an out-and-out lie. The cases were not thrown out as a result. Glendora didn't sue Cablevision in Philadelphia. Glendora didn't sue Cablevision in Los Angeles. Glendora didn't sue Cablevision in Detroit. Glendora sued, along with other plaintiffs, Cablevision in St. Louis. These people are stupid. Name this outside lawyer. If you don't mention him, all defendants flunk. Journalism 101 on a second count. Who, when, where, and why? That's what a journalist is to find out. Who, when, where, and why? You are sued for not giving the name and for cover-up and for collusion. You do not print the truth about Glendora. You do not print the truth about public access, a grand and indigenously American institution. You do not print the truth about Cablevision. You do not print the truth about the law. You do not print the truth about America, and you are sued thereby. Who is this outside lawyer? Crook Robert M. Calligy, whom Glendora has beaten in state court and in the Second Circuit and in the Southern District. Do you have the sense to get both sides? No. And you are sued for that. You should know enough. You flunked journalism 101. Defendants are hacks. They're not journalists. Litigious translates as patriotic. A woman has given all to stand up for the people's courts, your courts. You, in turn, have done nothing about its decay, and you witness daily. Galgano versus Dolan was filed in Missouri, since Missouri has no interest in Cablevision, and since it is not as easy for the Dolans to pay off the judges when Glendora corners the judges. Herein is further fear by Dolans to show shareholders the books, records, and minutes as mandated by New York statutes. Glendora has personal knowledge that Calligy et al. Have lied over 800 times. Prove, quote, the complaints were thrown out as a result, unquote. Just prove it. You are hereby sued for this. Are you a receiver for Cablevision? Do they buy ads in the New York Law Journal? Do they give you free tickets to their Knicks, the Rangers, Madison Square Garden, free coupons at the Wiz? Your prejudgment and bias are malodorous. Now, paragraph 18. Let me find that for you. In the more recent Missouri complaint, the letter has suggested that Glendora may be practicing law without a license. Cablevision's lawyers said they expect that case, too, will go no further. Okay, here's what's wrong with that paragraph. That will have to go into another edition. I'm sorry. It will have to go into the 9th edition. Now, paragraph 18 of the libelous New York Law Journal says that in the more recent Missouri complaint, the letter has suggested that Glendora may be practicing law without a license. Cablevision's lawyers said they expect that this case, too, will go no further. Well, Glendora says, what letter? It was a motion to the court. Maybe, quote unquote, the public wants facts, not maybes. The public wants proof, not wild speculation. You offend the laws, you offend newspaper readers. On two accounts, you are sued for Supra. Is Glendora the committing the same? Do you know? If you do know, then, if you do not know, then keep silence. Is Glendora giving legal advice without having a license? Did you interview Glendora to see if this is so? No. Are you professionals? Do you know Journalism 101, both sides? What is your paper worth with wild inflammatories instead of facts and proof? You are a failure. Even your lying cannot be written without being garbled and without your puerile construction. No, Glendora would never be a lawyer. There can be no worse extreme or existence than being a lawyer. Glendora will not sell her soul. You have sold your soul long ago and at a cheap price. To print Charles A. Former's infra-belt slur is a nadir of desperation. Cablevision has no meritorious defense for what they have done. And what is the meaning of the last sentence? What is to, quote unquote? Who cares what Cablevision's lawyers expect? Is this journalism? Is this anything more than Nazi gossip? Segway, nonetheless, quote unquote, is pertinent to nothing. This is embarrassing to fellow Homo sapiens. They expect this case will go no further, quote unquote. Is that news? That is prejudice. That is bias. That is malice. That is liable. And now, you, defendants, are the subject of a handwritten complaint. 43. Obviously, you have been bought by Cablevision. To be continued. We are up to page 28, 29, page 29 of the complaint, suing the New York Law Journal. To be continued, folks. This is Sunday night, August the 6th, year 2000, Anno Domini, and the time is 6 p.m. Oh. Wendy, Frankie, and Glennie labored at this desk for 4 hours making copies on this wonderful little copy machine. And we had to make 10 sets, 20 pages. But we got it done, and then we addressed the envelopes. We wrote a cover letter to the clerk, and this is on Glendora versus Trafficante and the New York State Neanderthal, New York State Court Officer, number 1763. I read you that earlier. And it's all printed, and the envelopes are addressed, and the address list is made, and the cover sheet is made, and the Informa Papyrus is done, and the service is done through Federal Rules of Civil Procedure Rule 4D, where you ask the defendants to waive the cost and expense of serving a summons. And so then we took it to the post office, and we mailed it, and it was all done by noon. But it took all day. Except that early in the day, I worked about 2 hours on Glendora versus the New York Law Journal. They did not print the truth about what's happening in public access. They did not print the truth about what's happening in Nassau. They did not print the truth about Cablevision. They did not print the truth about Glendora. So they are being sued for libel. That's a big one. It's about 36 pages already. So next we sat at our dining room table, and we had red flannel hash, and we ate up the leftovers for Sunday and Saturday. And then came legal paper number 3, which was Hilgartner, making a demand on Cablevision. And he is a lawyer on that. And he will strike fear into Cablevision's hearts. Well, they don't have any hearts, I forgot that. And because he's the one who won Moss versus Cablevision. And so that was the third legal paper, and that's all ready to be served. Franklin will take it to Bethpage and serve it personally tomorrow at Cablevision Systems Corporation. Outdoor office, the fourth legal paper was done. No legal papers were done on Sunday or Saturday. And the fourth one was done, the Public Service Commission, and writing them a big long letter and telling them that all of the Public Service Commission folder, everything has been read. This was the one over the telephone that I told you about. And these are the points in the letter that's being written to them. And here is the first page of the letter. And it's going through all of the papers in this great big folder. And I'll read you the letter when we get it done. And the fifth law suit, and last one for the day, was filing paginating hours and dollars. And the first one is Cablevision over here. This is about the 10th file drawer for Cablevision. And Cablevision's up to 22,000 pages. File paginate hours and dollars. And then file paginate hours and dollars, Bruiser Kin. That's the most recent file, volume 71. And then the street cleaner and golf. Fox is over with for the time being until he's sued on an omnibus lawsuit, and he can't be sued until the work is up to date and I have some free time. Then the omnibus will start. And so here's Kasari, hours and dollars on Kasari. That's the last volume of Kasari. And then the sixth one and final one is Glendora versus Gerald Levin, not letting people who are non-residents be on TV. That's a terrible violation of free speech. This is America. You ask Katie. What will you tell us, Katie, if we ask you? Oh, yes, you're absolutely right. Then the praying for Saturday was all behind, so that was done. But here's the crowning happiness of the day. It's around 6 p.m. This curtain looks so nice in here. The other one didn't look good at all. But doesn't that look pretty? Truss, let's take this curtain down and let's put it in office 2. Put it in office 1. Because this is the curtain that was in the living room window and it looks very nice here, don't you think? So let's take the 2 red curtains and put the 2 red curtains on one window and bring the other Penny's living room curtain and put it in this window and put the brand new curtain in Penny's window. That one looks good. And this one looks good. And now let's put in the Penny's curtain. Let's put it up here. This is the new curtain that Franklin bought. And that looks nice too. So that was a good rearrangement. And it's done. It's curtains for us. It's curtains for Frankie and Glenn. How was the chat with Glendora at 7 o'clock?
Sorry?
How was the chat with Glendora at 7 o'clock?
It was okay.
Was the audio okay?
Yeah.
No problem with the audio?
Uh-uh.
No problem with the video?
Nope.
Oh, good. It's on at 7 o'clock?
Yeah, it was. It was on at 7 o'clock.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Watch it. Hey, Bosa, come on over, Bosa. Hi. Where are you from?
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire.
Barbara, Barbara, come on out. We're waiting for you.
Do they have good lawyers in New Hampshire?
None. We got the worst. We're impeaching the Supreme Court up there. What more can I say?
Well, say a lot more. You got a few hours to do it.
I'm very good at what I do. Hey,
Harvey. What? Yeah, very good. Is this
our speaker
system? Yes, it is. I don't need that.
You got one now. Who's the one?
Won't work. I got brand new ones. Okay. Let me dress and drag then.
Oh, Glenn, Clark, good.
From New Hampshire, I hear. See, watch your wallets, watch your money. The ABA is in town, the American Bar Association. They're here to rip us off, and we're not going to allow it. We're here to give them a New York welcome. Welcome to the Apple, the Crooks. The crooks who are running the justice system in America. The crooks are here. $200 an hour. $400 an hour. $600 an hour. It's rip-off city in the justice system. And that's everybody's fault because we're putting lawyers in the office. The president, vice president, lawyers, 43% of all power.
Hi. Where are you from?
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire.
Barbara, Barbara, come on out. We're waiting for you.
Do they have good lawyers in New Hampshire?
No.
Thank you.
job at cashing out my stock than did TCI and AT&T. Much better. AT&T really ripped us off, and TCI. Quest was bad. They ruined U.S. West Telephone, Trujillo, Saul Trujillo. But at least they took care of your fractional share better than AT&T did and TCI. I was telling you about a White Plains hero, Alexander Hamilton, to a White Plains scoundrel, John P. de Blasi, who was caught. Instead of being in the courtroom for 31 mornings, he was caught by Gannett and Bruce Golding to be in Connecticut Broadcasting School taking a course in becoming a broadcaster. And I called de Blasi's chambers. It's here on the audio tape. I'll play it for you. And I said, is de Blasi there? And the woman says, no, he's in court. And I said, really? He's in court for a change? And then I asked the woman if he'd been fired yet, and she said no. This ends a chat with Glendora, White Plains, and Harrison, Los Alamos, Santa Fe, and West Seneca. There's nobody official in that town for you to pay it to. Folks, I wore yellow to church today, and the church bulletin was yellow. Isn't it pretty? A monarch butterfly. Whoever believes has eternal life. Those were good scenes of church that we had on other programs. This is a check, folks, for 1 cent. I thought that was quite remarkable. Again, this is from Quest, the company that took over U.S. West. So, there's something like a fractional share, and that's what it was worth. They said 1 cent. So I got a check for 1 cent. So I deposited it in the bank. Gave it to Franklin. He deposited it in the bank. Now, you remember how we went into the Uniondale Courthouse on February the 18th, 1997? It's about 3.5 years ago. And this insane Pinkerton named Kenneth H. Mildworm beat up Franklin and Glendora. He inflicted 6 bruises on Glendora, and he socked poor fragile Franklin, 78 years old, on the jaw, and both of us ended up on the floor. Well, that case is still going on. It was a case of 53 conspirators. And what they did to the United States of America. And the oral argument is coming up in the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit. And they give a pro se 5 minutes only. Now, that is discrimination. That is violation of free speech. If you're a lawyer, they'll have 15 minutes or they'll have 20 minutes, whatever. But they give a pro se 5 minutes. So we've got to do something about that someday. After this is over, maybe we'll sue them for that. We certainly will. Let me make a note of that. Hold on just a second. Sue, U.S. Court of Appeals, second, 5 minutes pro se. Discrimination. So here is my oral argument. You have to picture it that the plaintiff stands over here and there's a great big TV set so that the people in the back can see your face as you're facing the three judges. And over here is the defendant or the appellee, the appellant and the appellee. I'm the plaintiff, I'm the defendant and the appellant, and over here is the plaintiff and the appellee. And his name is Edgardo Ramos. And he's a crook. He's a United States attorney, U.S. attorney assistant. And so I am going to say to these three judges, standing before you is a man who made up a story, who used taxpayer funds to orchestrate 3,996 lies, who betrayed the United States of America, and who used the government's tools to protect himself and his friends instead of to protect the public, you. Edgardo Ramos calls himself the government. Well, he is the anti-government. But you are used to that. This is not the first time an assistant U.S. attorney has lied, stolen, and cheated. Edgardo Ramos has lied under the flag of the United States of America. Edgardo Ramos has lied before God. He has no personal knowledge of what happened February the 18th, 1997. 9:20 a.m. to 9:35 a.m. He was not there. Everything he tells you was removed once, twice, thrice from the scene. He cheated on discovery. Glendora had a federal rules of procedure right to discovery. He cheated on that. And Azraq cheated with him. Who is Azraq, folks? She's the United States Magistrate Judge. Why are United States judges afraid of United States attorneys? U.S. attorneys can ruin judges' careers. Now this judge, only a magistrate, was scared stiff of this U.S. attorney. She bowed to his every whim. She stooped to his level. She obsequiously acquiesced to his every violation of an American's rights. All judges do this at conferences, motions, and sidebars. But this one, Joan M. Azraq, was up for reappointment. Her 8 years were up in 3 months, so she capitulated to Ramos's every whim, every lie, every injustice. Like Edgardo Ramos, Joan M. Azraq sold her soul before my eyes. They sold their soul for a madman, Bruiser Ken, a 240-pound hulk, 50 years old, who socked a frail male, 78 years old, 125 pounds, in the jaw and sprawled him on the floor. Frail male, will you please stand up? Franklin, will you please stand up? Azraq Ramos, Robert Levy, Aileen Ross, Marilyn D. Goh, and Eugene M. H. Nickerson sold their souls for punk Kenneth H. Mildworm, who was canned 1.5 years later. Pinkerton lost the contract, and Glendora takes full credit. Glendora and Franklin have told you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and always have, so help them God. Edgardo Ramos, and those mentioned Super and the rest of the 54 conspirators never have told you the truth. The raison d'etre of these courts is to ascertain the truth. The evil Eastern District of New York failed atrociously. It is taxpayer waste and abuse of authority. Glendora never committed a crime in her life. She complains about and exposes crooked lawyers and corrupt judges. That is not a crime. That is patriotism. The real criminal is Edgardo Ramos, Bruiser Ken, and the entire civil RICO of 54 conspirators in the evil Eastern District of New York. 42 U.S. Code Section 1983 and Section 1985 and 18 U.S. Code Section 1963. 1983 is that if anybody who works for government violates your rights, that anybody is liable to you. Don't forget it. That's your civil rights. And 1985 is conspiracy. They conspired against you. And 18 U.S. Code 1963 is a civil RICO. The crimes against Glendora are pellucidly delineated in her hundreds of pages to you, which you, not clerks, have a USA duty to read and intercept. First Amendment retaliation, robbery of due process, robbery of Fourth Amendment right to an oath sworn to under penalty of perjury. Kwiatkowski, FBI, did not do that. Robbery of Fourth Amendment right to probable cause, speedy trial, deferred prosecution, a summons instead of a false arrest, a complaint of truth instead of a complaint of lies, ambush, discovery, waste of her and every American's taxpayer money, personal frolic, no official duty, not a federal officer, a cop for rent. That's all these Pinkertons are, retired New York City policemen out for rent. No outside witnesses, no physical evidence, no audio tapes, no videotapes, no photographs. Robbery of my witnesses, they wouldn't let my witnesses take the stand. Intimidation of jurors, forcing Glendora to take a legal advisor when she did not want one, and who, as you see today, is too cowardly to show for oral argument, Stuart Grossman. Then we have to add another one, that I had a right to a United States District Judge. This is by the Constitution of the United States, an Article III judge. Instead, Azraq was a magistrate, and so she robbed me of that right. This bunch of 53 hoods lied, stole, and cheated. All of them applauded the unmanliness of six bruises on a 71-year-old woman and punching a frail 78-year-old man on the jaw. Both victims ending up on the floor. They bent the system backwards, a retroflex, it is called, for to protect themselves and not the public. Do not think we, the public, do not know what is going on. We do. Glendora gets calls every week from victims of corruption in the courts. The nemesis nears. The end of the rope is here. Listen to Ramos' cheap offer. If Glendora will plead guilty, Franklin can go free. Outrageous, ridiculous, preposterous. There have been 210 TV reports on this betrayal to America. Glendora is on 23 cable systems, Montauk, New York to Portland, Oregon. It was a horrible experience, but we are glad we were called to expose it. Now, God is watching you, talking to these judges. What are you going to do? Betray the United States of America, as did Edward Edgardo Ramos and his 53 conspirators, or be a patriot and depurate the courts? These 54 have only made fools of themselves. Now Cassidy, that's Franklin's legal aid lawyer, has done her work well as it can be within these constraints. She calls for a retrial and proper guideline sentencing. Glendora asks for total and consummate reversal and to vacate and for full restitution of $23 million, punitive and compensatory damages, the cost of this action, and immediate discharge of Ramos and his gang of gangsters. Portland, Oregon. Please sponsor Glennie. We need somebody out there to sponsor. We're very proud of Portland, Oregon. And all the folks here in the Northeast think it's wonderful what you've been doing. So don't stop it. Find a sponsor. If you must have a sponsor, please find one. We sent out the application. It's supposed to get there today, the 14th. But we sent it from New York on Saturday, early in the morning. Folks, here's a great hymn. I played it for you many times, done by accomplished artists, vocal and instrumental. It's Blessed Assurance, Justifying Grace. And it's written by, the words are by Fanny J. Crosby, 1873. And that's terrible. The music is by somebody else, 1873. Oh, that's too bad, because the music is superlative. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Nine. There should be a flag here, and I can't find it. Here it is, page 29. And now you defendants are the subject of a handwritten complaint. Obviously, you have been bought by Cablevision. What you wrote about Glendora is a paid announcement. You have made statements which you knew were false, or which you should have checked to whether they were false. Defendants have shown a wanton and reckless disregard for the truth. Glendora is not a public figure, nor a limited public figure, as pertains to this action. And page 30, paragraph 47, is reserved. Now here's their paragraph 19. Nonetheless, Zabi maintained that the proposed rules would give Cablevision the ability to censor any program that was critical of the company, as her and Glendora's shows often are, or that it otherwise found unacceptable, and one rule in particular which would allow Cablevision to change the time and day a program is aired every 13 weeks has the producers particularly irked. Says Glendora, nobody can give Cablevision such a right. This is unconscionable. Clauses. It cannot stand up in court anywhere. A right given constitutional and or statutory cannot be usurped. Cablevision isn't giving us that right. You and I have that right by the Constitution and by the statutes. Cablevision took Glendora's program, off TV once because of content. They were sued in state court and federal court. They lost. Even Cablevision would not be stupid enough, ignorant, and arrogant enough to do that again. It was Former's job to divert the lawsuits, but he was nescient and negligent in not knowing or in not warning of 47 U.S. Code Section 531E and Title IX New York Code Rules and Regulations Section 595.4 and New York Executive Law Article 28 Section 829.3, now Public Service Law Section 229. Charles Former was either ignorant of all that or he deliberately and maliciously and knowingly violated the law. That's what he gets paid by our shareholders. Shareholders aren't getting any dividends. We give the money to him to stop lawsuits like this, to prevent them. Rather than the sophomoric sentence that ends paragraph 19, defendant Meade should have cited Cablevision's violations of both state and federal law, first come, first served. Cablevision's Maurice Cunningham was standing on her head at the quarterly producers' meetings in Rockland, Westchester, Hoppog, Riverhead, and Lynbrook. Let me make a note to ask about those quarterly meetings. Maurice blithely ejaculated, "We want to give new producers a chance to be on TV. This is first come and first serve. The law says." Well, this is a magnanimous gesture, but it is not what the law is. We were there first, and we are to be served first. But Cablevision's ignorance of the law and arrogance in breaking the law of New York State and the United States of America is not news. As a shareholder, Glendora protests the money that the Dolans spend on ignoring the law, breaking the law, and paying a liar for hire to cover up their arrogant bad citizenship. The Dolans never have the figures available at the annual meetings, how much they have spent in litigation. This is a figure that Lawrence Tisch, when he owned CBS, always had at his fingertips for Evelyn Y. Davis. Former was ejected from Charles Former, how he was ejected from United States Magistrate Judge Mark D. Fox, how he was ejected from Fox's courtroom. And the tape ran out. So I have to go back here and say in 1996, Fox ordered Former to leave the courtroom because Former was quote-unquote making faces. Look up the record, and Glendora has it on audio tape. Magistrates do not have court stenographers. The record is kept on audio tape, which can be purchased for $15. We're up to page 33. A grievance against liar for hire Robert M. Callagy was filed 2 years ago. Read it. Shira Scheinlin has it. A. Callagy was disbarred by the Second Department. Read it. Paragraph 20. Meade's article is superficial and supercilious. Cablevision has a monopoly, says Meade, on Long Island, and it is using that monopoly against us. And this is a quote from Zabby. Well, c'est vrai. That is true. For example, the 13-week rule could be used to bridge our constitutional right to free speech. Anytime cable doesn't like something a public access producer has to say, it can reprogram that show to 2 a.m. on Tuesday morning, said Zabby. Well, Cablevision has no power, says Glendora, to abridge free speech. You simply sue them. Again, Cablevision is not a state actor. In Glendora's 1993 lawsuit, Cablevision was acting in collusion with state actors, County Supervisor Galater and Consumer Affairs Commissioner James Pickett, for telling James A. Kofalt to take Glendora off of TV. Glendora was reporting that Galater and Pickett were not protecting you consumers of Nassau County by allowing Scott Lord to operate an underground lawn sprinkler business without a consumer affairs license. Billionaire Dolan stole the subpoena money. The trial was all set to select a jury, folks, on March 3, 1997. By federal rules of civil procedure, anybody who is subpoenaed has to be paid in advance for time and travel. This amounted to $350 that Franklin paid Charles and James and three other Cablevision defendants in advance. At any cost to eschew an American's duty to go to court and testify the truth, the Dolans put the money into the party and got the trial adjourned. They poured other money. Now, Charles L. Bryant, the United States District Judge, made a fool of himself manufacturing a reason to rob Glendora of her trial. And he was appealed three times and sued several times. Knowing fully well that the trial was zapped, billionaires Dolans did not return the $350 subpoena and put it in their bank. They stole the subpoena money. They knew fully well that the trial had been adjourned. Galata, Pickin, and a third consumer affairs defendant returned the money. Cheapskates Dolan kept the money for 1.5 years and refused Glendora's multiple demands to return it to Franklin. They kept it until ordered by the court to return it. To this day, the cheapskates have not paid Franklin the 9% statutory interest for using his money for 1.5 years. But cheapskate Callagy was ordered by Bryant three times to pay Glendora $125 for the audio tape Callagy demanded as evidence that Cablevision censored Glendora's program on the basis of content. Callagy defied the court five times. Callagy has not paid the $125 yet. And this is all in the docket, Glendora versus Cablevision. The New York Law Journal had a story on this subpoena issue, but not a good story. Supra shows the failure of defendants to inform the public of what is really happening, and they have a duty to America to do so. They have a duty to inform to you what is happening. Glendora does not live far from the site of Peter Zenga and Free Press. Now, who are the defendants? See Infra. Well, this is the whatever you call it in a newspaper. Bruce Wasserstein is the owner of American Lawyer Media Incorporated. American Lawyer Media Incorporated is the second defendant. George E. Dillahay is the publisher, and Lee Jones is a Long Island editor, and Julia C. Mead is the writer of this article. The New York Law Journal is also a monopoly and abuses America. Now, paragraph 21. The outcry from producers across eastern Suffolk County and from the town boards in Southold and Southampton. Now, Glendora says, this is so parochial. The outcry was across Nassau, across Westchester, and across Rockland. And Cablevision to withdraw the proposed set of rules before they were to take effect on July 1st, but only for the time being, said Joan Gilroy, Cablevision spokeswoman and franchise manager. Glendora says that the defendants, the New York Law Journal, you get paid to interview Cablevision and produce their and reproduce their side, but you fail America to get the other side. This article by Mead is hopelessly untimely. The article is dated July 10th. Cablevision capitulated on June 19th. You know, that's like 3 weeks. The odious anathema was that nearly a month ago. Again, defendants failed their country. 70 public access producers stormed into Rockland Cablevision at the first quarterly producers meeting. It was a near riot. They shouted, they shook their fists, they converged on Maurice Cunningham and Cablevision program director Dan Ciccone. In groups of 10 at a time, they walked out in protest. Quote, you did not consult us first, quote, and quote, you are wasting our time, quote. Cablevision's capitulation is a major victory for the public access producer movement. Defendants entirely missed the significance. Defendants did not read Glendora's marginalia, interlinears, and annotations on the Cablevision PEG access kit, the anathema. It cites the law as broken. It was the first protest to hit the fan. Paragraph 22, column 5, three columns to go. Cablevision has been committed and remains committed to public access, said M.S. Gilroy. Well, Glendora says this is chocolate-covered cyanide. Ha-ha, ho-ho, and hee-hee. Rank violation of the Public Service Commission franchise renewal laws. Ms. Gilroy added that it was an oversight that the rules were circulated without the town's approval. But she said the company was now revising them based on rulings from the Public Service Commission and on the town input. You can always count on Cablevision to lie. Defendants failed to mention that Cablevision vice president in charge of the kit exited to Seattle. Paragraph 23, the underlying this is so so faint, this wording. The underlying idea was to make the rules fair for all producers, but also to secure Cablevision's investment in its equipment, Gilroy said. In Riverhead in particular, that the producers had become accustomed to having free rein at all hours of the day and night. Well, that's Riverhead Steve Laurie, who's the greatest public access coordinator who ever lived. He was so good at public access, he was fired 1.5 years ago. Any Cablevision employee who is good at public access gets fired. Discovery. Did defendants interview the New York State Public Service Commission? What is needed here is John Figliosi's statement to Glendora. Cablevision made an innocent mistake. They thought the rules in Connecticut and in New Jersey could be applied in New York, but these rules are against New York law. Diversity of citizenship. Paragraph 24. This is supposed to be first come, first serve. Non-discriminatory. But some of the producers thought they were entitled to have a primetime slot for the rest of their lives, Gilroy said. Well, they happen to be right about that. That is the law. The law is first come, first serve. And we're there first, and we have to be served first. Though the studio is open 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, she said, some producers are demanding that we be open Sunday and have the cafeteria available too. That's all in one paragraph, and it's all non sequitur. It's three different concepts. Glendora congratulates the New York State Public Service Commission for their role in smashing to oblivion the odious and anathema Cablevision PEG access kit. But Glendora has a cause of action against the Public Service Commission, insisting on a local sponsor. People do not want to sponsor public access programs. Wherefore, therefore, and ergo, the Public Service Commission has to be sued for violating its own law. The commission cannot limit nor prohibit public access. Public Service Law, Section 229. Glendora plaintiff is confident in every defendant's paragraph there will be a lie, so she just lists the next paragraph as libelous without even reading it. And this part was written on August the 7th, and today is August the 15th, so that's about a week ago. Paragraph 25, column 6, controversial shows. Gilroy said that she had to air the cablecast the show when she really didn't want to. Now, this article is paid for by Cablevision, as you can see, increasingly. This article is pro-Cablevision. What did defendants receive in exchange? Just as Cablevision buys judges, so does Cablevision buy press. Paragraphs 26 and 27, Ibid. It made me sick, said Gilroy, to play that program. And then he speaks of another one. And Glendora says, willingly or not, quote, unquote, must be expatiated upon or left out of print. Now, what do they mean by that? Paragraph 28. Meanwhile, writes the New York Law Journal, though the Public Service Commission, something, the 13-week rule was that Southold and Southampton officials have backed the producers by writing strongly worded letters to Cablevision asserting that their franchise agreements gave them the authority to approve the rules ahead of time. Of course it does. That's part of the franchise law. To approve or not approve, says Glendora. Did Riverhead get the second public access channel? What was left over from Father Tom Dolan's pet? Then Glendora came to Long Island and made public access producers aware of their rights and shareholders' rights aware of their ownership. Paragraph 31, the last column. And names Horwood of the Washington, D.C. firm of Spiegel, etc. Something dated the East Hampton and the trend on East End by definition of gross. He refined the definition of gross revenue, that it should include the premium programs and it should include the advertising revenue that Cablevision gets, and that therefore the community should get 5% of that also. The law is very clear on what gross revenue is, but leave it to the greedy Dolans to obfuscate, squeeze, and wringer. Recall the 1999 base salary of James L. Dolan. He got $950,000 a year base salary. He got another $4 million in bonuses, and he got another $4 million in other compensation, which they don't specify, and which I want to see the books, records, and minutes to find out what it was. Focus on the recent request for rate increase. Where does the money go? You have the answer. Read the annual report. Read the proxy statement. $30,000 a year to pals on the board, and $500 a board, $2,000 a board meeting, and $500 a telephone conference. We are up to page 45. The Dolans will not let Glendora shareholder go to board meetings. Why? Well, shareholders are not allowed to go to board meetings. Famous quote at the annual meeting of June 17th, 2000, 10:30 a.m. Who owns the company? Shareholders. Everything with Cablevision is a matter of negotiation, a euphemism for dollars. Paragraph 32. Meanwhile, ongoing public meetings meant to help Southold and other town towns define the issues have also helped crystallize the negotiations there, said Mr. Yabrowski. Those of us left who own our own souls, says Glendora, can read between these lines. I can't even read the lines. The print is so faint. The main issue is public access. That says it all. All the other issues are sub-issues, said Yakubowski. Glendora says, expatiate. The article ends, and readers still do not know who, when, where, what, and why. And here's a picture of a public access producer who is a lawyer. And he has a show every week and has had for some years. What is his name? William J. Fleming. Public Access Channel, their franchise entitles them to give us some news for a change. Paragraph 29, column 7, next to the last column. Greg Yagabowski, the Southhold town attorney, said the town had for years been content to extend its old franchise agreement over and over, increasing the franchise fee paid by Cablevision to the town leads to an increase in customer rates. If the town gets an increase of the, see, the cable company has to pay 5% to the municipality for the use of the public way. And if that 5% increases, well, then Cablevision takes it out of the subscribers, goes after the subscribers for a rate increase. A second channel for government and a third for educational is a municipality's right. They must protect the public's right to have some, have the same. Cablevision for years got by with using just Channel 5, which was a religious channel, Telecare, Charles Dolan gave it to his buddy, Father Tom. And then we were stuck on Channel 25. We didn't have our own channel, which is against the law. We're supposed to have a designated channel. Okay. Defendants are now the subjects of a handwritten complaint. Coverage of Public Service Commission rule is grossly deficient. Coverage by other public access producers is pitifully scant. Coverage of Mark Shukin, a Cablevision vice president, and his leaving is non-existent. Zabby did a whole lot more than is delineated in the article. The article is obviously a Cablevision buy. Other than greed, does this article explore Cablevision's motivation to zap public access, to wit? Court defeats such as Moss versus Cablevision, Glendora versus Cablevision, Glendora versus the Board of Directors, Glendora versus Kofault. And I left one out, McClellan versus Cablevision. Glendora Graphics, greed is written all over their faces. And, quote, cable TV is a license to steal. Quote, no dividends. The dollars go into the pockets. Quote, no interest on the $350 they stole ad infinitum. What holds up the negotiations is Cablevision's avarice and censorship. This article, the subject of this lawsuit, is simpleton. It is abominably inaccurate. It is frivolous. Obviously, it is a sellout to Cablevision. It sinks with not giving the public what it wants to know and giving the public what it does not want to know. This particularly refers to the Cablevision paid comments on Glendora. Its basic journalism defects have been listed. Who, when, why, where, what. Yet both sides, inter alia. Its libel violations are listed herein. Willful, wanton, intentional, reckless, disregard of the truth, printed with knowledge of falsity, stupidity in not checking and ascertaining the truth, published with serious doubts as to the truth, inter alia. Glendora has been in public access since 1972, 28 years when it started. She knows whereof she speaks. She has done 22,785 half-hour programs as of last Tuesday, and we are now up to, this one is 2,790. She will do another 10 next Tuesday, August 15th, that's today. Even if defendants had been astute enough not to mention Glendora, Glendora would sue for the harm defendants have done to the public, that's to you, and to the public access movement. Defendants failed to reference the all-important law, public service law, section 229. Here's a picture of it, folks. And I'll read it to you. One, the commission may not prohibit or limit public access. No municipality may prohibit or limit public access. No cable operator, no cable television company may limit or prohibit public access. The failure to mention section 229 prejudices the public, you, and prejudices public access. Therefore and ergo, defendants had their chance to show what public access, a grand indigenously American institution, is all about, and they bombed. Instead, they took money to write good about Cablevision and bad about Glendora and about public access. For all reasons stated, pages 1 to 52, Glendora sues for $60 million, punitive and compensatory damages, the costs of this action, and all further relief just and proper. Dated White Plains, New York, August the 11th, 2000, Anno Domini, yours in truth, Glendora. When Cablevision took Glendora's program off of TV and Glendora sued Cablevision and the courts told Cablevision to put the program back on TV, this story made the New York Law Journal. And this was in 1994. Also, there was a big story in Newsday, the Long Island newspaper, but let me get you the color copy of this. It's much prettier. Black and white doesn't do it justice. And in addition to justice, we need mercy. Here's the color picture. Well, you have a nice orange band on the hat and an orange blouse, an orange vest rather, and orange bottoms, and a navy blue jacket. Orange and navy blue, you see, are the colors of Nassau County, where Cablevision is headquartered and steals your money. And it was quite a big story. It went on for... And then the New York Times had an article about it.